start. Mr. Deputy Chairman, this resolution, insofar as it goes to evolve a scheme for the translation and preparation in Hindi and in all regional languages of standard textbooks and connected works for higher education and research, including scientific and technical studies, is an excellent resolution. It is a harmless one, and I am sure that the House will express its view on it. We are happy that those things are there, but it is not a very easy task to carry out this translation in Hindi and all regional languages. I would ask where you have got the personnel, the trained personnel, for carrying out these translations. Have you collected the standard textbooks and connected works for higher education and research, first of all? Have you gathered the material to be handled? And secondly, have you got the trained personnel to cope with this work, sir? This requires very carefully investigation, simply because we are dealing not with factories or industrial products, but with the minds of people ranging from childhood to the university stage, with their development in regard to ideas and concept. It is a very, very important point to consider whether we have got these two in readiness before we attempt such a task. Sir, I find that as it is change over from one language to another, from one medium to another, has been attempted with very injurious effects on the minds of children as well as of the teaching staff. There is a great deal of confusion from the school to the university stage over this question. We cannot perform a coup d'etat or a change overnight on this problem that concerns the minds of the young. Therefore, sir, with all due respect, I would request any committee or any scheme that is launched to go very warily into this subject and to study all the repercussions it will have before such a thing is attempted. An over-hurried translation has resulted in tragedies in the schools as well as in the colleges. Examination papers had been set and evaluations had been undertaken in the so-called regional languages, one examiner differing from the other with regard to the terms that were used in those questions and answers. Therefore, we should not play with fire, as it were. Language is the life of a nation, of a people. Therefore, we are dealing with this question of language. All languages are important, in my opinion. I will not say that Hindi is not important or the regional languages. In fact, we should provide opportunities for the promotion and cultivation of all languages in our country. In this connection, I would say that while there should be a common language, it will take a long time before Hindi becomes a language of use in many parts of India. The argument has been given again and again. And while Hindi gives an advantage to the Hindi-speaking areas, those parts of the country which have absolutely nothing in common with this language will take a long time before they accept the change. That point is very vital to the transactions, to the impositions of these books of Hindi or non-Hindi speaking people. Therefore, all that I can say is that you must go about cautiously, because Hindi is going to be a common language for the country, and in translating books into Hindi and in giving such books to the people, we must be very careful that the terms that are commonly accepted by all should be adopted. In this connection, I would request that while this work is going on, we should not try to translate literally commonly accepted terms from one language to another. Whether they have come from the English language or from Sanskrit should be checked. Commonly accepted terms that have come into the use of not only the 5 million English educated people of this country, but even to the vocabulary of the masses in rural areas, should not be literally translated simply because these terms are in English or in Sanskrit. I am saying this because you have got the zeal for the regional languages or Hindi, that they must be converted, even if the translation takes a whole line instead of a small little word. That should not be done, the words, so long as they have come into common parlance, even among the masses, like tram, bus, court, college, parliament, etc., need not be translated into a regional language or into Hindi. In the same way, I would say with regard to humanities that I have taught political science and economics and other sociological subjects, and there too the terms are difficult to be translated. And where lecturers who are well qualified in regional languages have attempted this translation, the student could not follow, nor could two lecturers follow the terms that were being used. I am not saying that until eternity we should have the continuation of any particular language, namely English. Mr. Chairman, the Motorist Transport Workers Bill, the Select Committee's report on which we are considering now, is one which has received the support of all sections of the House. It is designed to standardize the conditions of service of the workers engaged in this country and to give them some, at least, of the important reliefs which workers in general in the country get. This bill is in line with the progressive policy of the government to improve conditions of labor. The opposition members, at least some sections of the opposition who castigate the government for ignoring the interests of labor, should remember that this is one more measure with which they agreed. And therefore, while blaming the government, they should keep this in mind. The bill as it has emerged from the Select Committee is a great improvement in this connection. We must remember the expert knowledge which most of the members of the Select Committee brought to bear on the deliberations of the Select Committee. I consider it to be one of the well-constituted committees. Inasmuch as there were many members on this committee who had specialized in labor, both from the opposition sections of both houses as well as from the Congress side, we were fortunate to have a union ex-labor minister on the committee whose knowledge really helped the committee to come to very successful conclusions. The select committee was also assisted by persons engaged in this industry. Both employers and laborers, as many as 20 memoranda were presented, and most of them gave oral evidence before the committee, so much so there was not a single clause or part of a clause or even a phrase which went without being well considered. That is how the bill has come to be great improvement on the bill as introduced. I personally think that the deliberations of the committee were so very well conducted that the report has come to weigh more on the side of the employees, and therefore there is likely to be no room for complaint in this connection. Sir, I must also mention that the Deputy Minister of Labour, who was the government's representative present on the committee, was very responsive to all the suggestions made, and there was not the least resistance on his part in admitting whatever was offered as a suggestion and which went to improve the bill. The Select Committee has made some significant changes in the bill. The first change that it made was with regard to Clause 1, with regard to the enforcement of the bill. This has been referred to in great detail in the discussion today. The original bill did not fix any date. The date was left open to be prescribed by the central government. It was also open to the state governments to fix different dates. There was a long discussion about this in the select committee, and the government side represented their difficulties in the way of enforcement of this bill and why they could not fix a particular date in the bill itself. After much discussion, it was agreed that the date should be definitely fixed, because several transport concerns were interested in seeing that the provisions of this bill were put off from coming into force as long as possible. One could understand their position, in as much as great responsibility devolved on the transport concerns by virtue of this measure, for instance, establishment of canteens, rest houses, this and that. It should be remembered that the concerns we are dealing with here are not concerns like factories where they are concentrated, where the hours of work and the work itself is confined to a limited area. Here we have big concerns and small concerns, and whereas it should be open to the big concerns to establish rest houses or canteens without much difficulty, it would certainly be a great hardship for small concerns to come out with the same thing. In spite of all that, the select committee came to the conclusion that the date should be fixed as 31st December 1981. Now the Honorable Minister is introducing an amendment to have this date as July 1982. Perhaps he will give his reasons. As far as I can anticipate, it is only the practical difficulties that the state governments will be facing in giving effect to the various provisions of this bill that have influenced him to put off the date by 6 months. If the date is put off by 6 months, there is not going to be any danger resulting from it. It would be better to do that if the government wants time in order to make these arrangements and also to enable the transport concerns to provide themselves with the several things that this bill requires them to do. I should not be a great difficulty at all. Therefore, for my own part, I do not object to the date being extended to July 1982, full stop.